Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in Louisiana. Still down here for a few more days. The Lord's been showing me lots of stuff, guys. I just don't know where to begin. So, I guess by the grace of God, I've got a couple of videos to make. The first video I wanted to make was just a reference to the Olympics. As I was meditating today on the Word of God, and the Lord just reminded me of this. I've mentioned this in videos way back. You know, there's some people that are into all this symbolism of the Olympics and TV commercials and whatever, TV shows and all this. This is the messages, or the subliminal messages, of the enemy. These are not from God. These are from the enemy. So, the Olympics. What does the Olympics really represent? Well, it's very simple, brothers and sisters. If you know about Mount Olympus, the Olympiads, Clash of the Titans, all this kind of stuff. So the Olympics is ancient ceremonies and ancient sporting events that commemorates actually, brothers and sisters, the Nephilim, the half fallen angel, half human giants that were on the earth. Just like a Mount Olympus, the Olympics. The Olympics is about celebrating superhuman strength. The Nephilim, it's about celebrating one world unity, one world coming together. And this all dates back, brothers and sisters, to the time of the Nephilim. Now, I wanted to read a few Bible verses to you, brothers and sisters. Because what the Lord was speaking to me about on this topic was about the sons of God. Now, in the New Testament, it says that to those who would believe on the name of Jesus, John chapter 1, to them the Lord Jesus Christ gave power. The Lord Jesus Christ gives power to those who believe on him, who become born again, to become the sons of God. Romans chapter 8, verse 14 says, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. So in the New Testament, we can become sons of God. So this is what the Lord was speaking to me about today. In the Old Testament, there is one person who is a son of God, one human. But that is written in the New Testament. In the Gospel of Luke, I do believe it's chapter 3, it gives the chronology of the Lord Jesus Christ going backwards. Matthew goes forward. Luke goes backwards. One gives the genealogy through Mary and the other through Joseph. Anyway, going backwards, brothers and sisters, in the Gospel of Luke, it gets back to Adam, all the way back to Adam, and it says, and Adam, who was the Son of God. So Adam is called the Son of God, the only human in the Old Testament called a son of God. Now, this is where people get confused who do not want to take the Bible literally. The first rule of biblical interpretation is the Bible is to be taken literally unless otherwise stated. As an example, Revelation chapter 1, it says that John looked and he saw, you know, someone walking between these candlesticks, and you know, his hair was like wool. You know, that's so funny because there are racist people who black people who try to, you know, go, you know, argue and debate that Jesus was black, and which, you know, Jesus may have been. You know, it's not the point. The point is they're making it like black people are superior, black people are the sons of God, and they use this text where John says his hair was white like wool, his feet were like brass. I've heard many of the on the internet and in person. I know several, you know, actively racist black people who try to twist Christianity into, you know, black people are the only Christians and they're like God. Everybody else is lower than them. But if you read the text, for one thing, it's an allegoric text. That's an example of a text that is symbolic, not literal, because it goes on to say that he has eyes like fire, red like fire. I've never seen a human with red like fire eyes. Maybe albino people have some kind of pinkish colored eyes, but not red like fire. And it says, out of his mouth proceeded a sharp two-edged sword. I've never seen a human with a sharp two-edged sword out of their mouth. So that right there is a clue that it's all allegoric and metaphoric and symbolic. And then the Lord goes on to explain to him the meaning of that. That when you saw the seven lampstands represents the seven messengers or the seven angels of the seven churches. You know, are the stars that you saw in his right hand. It's also, he has seven stars in his right hand. Are the seven churches. You know, the sword is, of course, we know from the Bible, is the word of God. The sharp two-edged sword. The eyes like fire, it doesn't say in the Bible, in that text, but it represents the Lord is coming in judgment. His feet like brass, also going through the fire of judgment. The Lord will put the Christians through the fire, as it tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We'll pass through the fire. At the judgment seat of Christ, the Bema seat of Christ. That's for Christians at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Before the marriage supper of the Lamb, we have the judgment seat of Christ for the church. Anyway, brothers and sisters, in the Old Testament, the sons of God, written in the Old Testament, is used for angels. And this is what the Lord wanted me to talk about, emphasize in this message. Now, some examples are in Job. Job chapter 1, verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Job chapter 1, verse 6. Job chapter 2, verse 1. Again, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them to present himself before the Lord. Now, that's two. Here's a third one. Job chapter 38, verse 7. And in this text, God is questioning Job. You know, he's telling Job, where were you when I created the stars? Where were you when I did this? Where were you when I did that? So in Job chapter 38, verse 7, God is saying to Job, where were you when the morning stars sang together and all the sons of God shouted for joy? All the sons of God were shouting for joy. So we see that the sons of God in the Old Testament are the fallen angels. Are all the angels, I'm sorry, not only the fallen angels, but all the angels referred to as the sons of God. So, let's see. Genesis chapter 6, brothers and sisters, it says, let's see, I've got this little, I'm trying to look at this thing up here. I'm trying to look at his sword, and I've got this open at the same time, the camera. So, excuse me while I go to Genesis chapter 6. And it, Genesis chapter 6, verse 1, and it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw that the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives, all of which they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not always strive for man, for he is also, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, after the flood, there were giants. Yeah, of course, Goliath being the most famous. There was, when the children of Israel started going to promised land, there were giants in the land. That's why they were afraid when they went to the promised land, because they said, we're like grasshoppers to these people. They were giants. There's about four or five different groups. The Rephaim, all of these different groups, were giants. Their bloodline was contaminated. You know, I wrote about this a lot in the book that the Lord gave me to write. The name of the book, which I only have two copies I had in the Philippines. I don't have any copies with me here in the States. All of them are in North Carolina, and then I have some in Las Vegas also, but I have none here with me in Louisiana. Final boarding call, Satan's plan for the ages and our last mission. Brothers and sisters, if you'd like a copy, you can get it on Amazon.com. If you want a signed copy, the information is below every video that I make. I talked extensively about this, but the Lord is having me. I just remember that it's in the book. The Lord had me to talk about this because the Lord has been leading me, of course, to study, as the Lord continues to lead me to study about the coming Antichrist, and the preaching that I do is revival. The preaching that the Lord leads me to do is to bring holiness, repentance, which leads to revival for the Christians, for Christians, backslidden, lukewarm, half-baked, sleeping at the wheel Christians. Those slumbering and sleeping virgins that need to have their oil before it's too late. You know, it's not too late to get your oil. And that's the purpose of my preaching. But the teaching that the Lord has me doing and the research that the Lord has me doing is Satan's plan for the ages. Okay? And the Lord has been having me study and giving me lots of information to go forward about discovering what's happening further along with this new world order that's coming. Why? Because it's probably for those who will be left behind, for those sleepy Christians to wake up. So I say that because there's always someone that says the cliche, the shallow cliche, without thinking and saying, oh, I'm looking for the coming of the Lord and not looking for the Antichrist. There are people who will get saved when they hear about the Antichrist. When they look at what's going on in the world and hear some information from the Bible and say, hey, wait a minute, this is going on now. Hey, I need to get right with the Lord. I need to wake up. I need to come out of my backslidden state. I need to come out of my sleeping and slumbering state. And I need to go get my oil before it's too late, before the wedding party departs. Genesis chapter 6, brothers and sisters. Let's see. Verse 4, I was already there. For there were giants in the earth in those days, and also after, as I mentioned, Goliath is an example. When the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare them children to them, and the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. Now that mighty man is Gibborim. The Bible says Nimrod became a Gibborim. A Gibor is singular, Gibborim, plural. He became a mighty man, men of renown. See, in the King James, it makes it sound like they were great, but they were not. Just like it talks about Nimrod becoming a mighty hunter before the Lord. He was not, it seems like in the King James, it's saying that he was like, you know, God was proud of him. That's not what it's saying. That is not what the text is saying. It's not saying that here. They were famous for being wicked. They were famous for bringing evil. And then listen to what God is saying. And God saw that the wickedness of men was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of heart were on evil continuously. See how this has come together? Man is getting more wicked and wicked and wicked and doing all these evil things. At the same time, God is about to bring his judgment. Jesus said, when the Lord got me on this topic was in 2009, when I moved from a rural area in the Philippines to a more of an urban area so I could have the internet and all this, 2009. That's the time that the Lord spoke to me about this. And the Lord kept giving me the Bible verse for himself. The Lord himself spoke in Matthew chapter 24, and he said, as the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man. Now Jesus says they were eating and drinking, and then the flood came suddenly. So one thing about that text is there's nothing new about eating and drinking and getting married. It says that people were going along on their own business and boom, sudden destruction came upon them like a flood. And they shall not escape, it tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Sudden destruction comes and they will not escape. And that is a fact. And that's something else the Lord's been talking to me about this week. That's why I haven't made a video about it. The Lord's been talking to me about his sudden destruction and judgment. But before that happens, brothers and sisters, there are signs and evidence to give people the warning, the heads up, hey, things are going south. In the days of Noah, Noah was preaching. The Bible says Noah was a preacher of righteousness. Enoch was a preacher of righteousness. Enoch was preaching of the coming destruction. Moses, or Noah, was telling them that, hey, the flood's coming. Lots of people saw him building the ark in a dry land. You know, and there was no rain. Before the flood, there was no rain. The Bible says that a mist came out of the ground to water the land. And then after, of course, that's when God opened up the heaven. And then he changed the structure of the sky. He changed the structure of the earth. Water came up from the deep. Water came down. That greenhouse effect was ended. And then the earth is as it is today, as God changed the structure pre-flood to the post-flood, or, you know, antediluvial age, as they call it. And now we're in the post-diluvial age, the deluge or the flood of Noah. So, brothers and sisters, the sons of God were these fallen angels, as it tells us in Jude. They kept not their first estate. They gave up their first estate and came to earth. Now, brothers and sisters, in that word, estate is talking about not necessarily their place in the heavens, like they left their, you know, that's what I thought it meant when I first read that they left their, the second heaven. In this case, they were watchers. Those angels We're watchers. The watchers, as it talks about in Daniel, the watchers, the book of Enoch, which is quoted from extensively in the Bible, that was in the canon of scriptures and removed. Even Daniel talks about the angels who are watchers. Watchers. And so these angels were watchers, and then they fell in love with these women, and they decided to leave their estate. What is their estate? The vessel that they were in. They left their angel vessel and came in the form of men. Now, lots of people don't know this because they don't know their Bible. Let me say this. When the two angels went to Sodom and Gomorrah, the people thought they were men. When the angel of the Lord, the captain of the Lord's host, a pre-incarnated Christ, that was the Lord Jesus Christ himself, they call it a Christophany, when Joshua was about to take Jericho, he saw the Lord of Sabaoth is the proper name for, in the Old Testament, it gives the improper name. It says the captain of the Lord's host. The New Testament gives the proper name for that which is the Lord of Sabaoth. Okay, the Lord of Sabaoth, that's a Hebrew word. And that is the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And he appeared as a man there to Joshua. And Joshua saw him and said, "Who, you know, whose side are you on? Are you for us or against us?" And he said, "I'm not for you or against anybody. You know, I'm the captain of the host of the Lord's army." Appeared as a man. Joshua thought it was a man. And those two angels who were going into Sodom and Gomorrah, everybody thought they were humans. But they were angels. And the Lord, that's another example of the Lord appearing also, because there were two angels and the Lord who appeared to talk to Abraham at his tent before the two angels departed and went into Sodom and Gomorrah. There were no more three, but only two. And the Lord stayed and really talked to Abraham, and Abraham interceded for the people of Sodom and Gomorrah after the Lord told him he would destroy the place. If all the evil that he had been hearing about was true, he would destroy the place. So the angels went there to investigate. So now that I'm on that topic, it also alludes to this fallen angels as the days of Noah and the rapture and the tribulation. Now, God brought immediate destruction on Sodom and Gomorrah because of their homosexuality. But also, not only that, brothers and sisters, but it says they went after strange flesh. Now, when I first read that, the first meaning, of course, is men having contact with the flesh of someone other than the proper way, i.e. sodomy, strange flesh. God intended for a man to unite with a female in the normal way to have children, not in sodomy. So strange flesh would be going after the flesh of a man instead of a woman. But a second level of that, brothers and sisters, is the strange flesh of fallen angels. Fallen angels being strange flesh, not being human flesh. Now the Lord even referred to that as he said, remember Lot. When the Lord Jesus Christ himself referred to the tribulation, he talked about remember Lot. And the Lord referred back to that same time period as the days of Noah were and as the days of Lot were. What was going on that day? Men were going after strange flesh. In this case, flesh at one level, homosexuality, at another level, sex between angels and humans. Another thing, where that barrier is crossed outside your own kind. Now, brothers and sisters, to bring this to another level, in the book of Revelation, the Antichrist is never called the Antichrist. That's from 1 John. In the book of Revelation, the Antichrist is known as what? Think about it. It's called the mark of the beast. The mark of the beast. Now, what is a beast? Now, if I have a man, it's a man. If I have a dog, it's a dog. If I have an angel, it's an angel. What if I take half dog and half cat and mix it together? What do I have? I've got a beast. God made a spirit or a soul for dogs. God made a soul for cats. If I mix a dog and a cat together, where is the soul for that creature? There, it is a beast. It is a vessel that is an open host to be possessed by a demonic spirit. Now that's really the reason all this is all about, brothers and sisters. Just like when a demon tries to possess someone, they're looking for a host. They're looking for something to possess. Why not make your own? You're creating. Satan wants to copy God by creating. So we go back to the Olympics, brothers and sisters. We go back to ancient times. We see the Sphinx in front of the pyramid. We see the ancient Pegasus, a horse with wings. We see the satyr or whatever. You see, this is like the body of a horse and the head and chest of a man. We see all these things of mixed animals from ancient times. These things are partially rooted in truth, brothers and sisters. Even as it says in the book of Enoch, which I referred to, that's been taken out of the canon of Scripture, it says that all flesh became corrupted. Even in Genesis, what does it say? Look at Genesis right here. Let's start at Genesis 6, verse 9. I've talked about this before, but some of you guys have not seen my videos. In Genesis 6, verse 9, these are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man and perfect in his generations. And Noah walked with God. Not only was he a good guy and all that, he was perfect. What does that mean? And it says, and Noah begot three sons, Ham, Shem, and Japheth. Verse 11, the earth also was corrupted before God, and the earth was filled with violence. Okay? And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupted, and all flesh had corrupted his way before on the earth. Now, people had become corrupted. And then God said unto Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them. And I will destroy them from the earth. Okay. So you've got the corruption of people's sin. Now, what was corrupting them, part of it, what was teaching them all these violent things, were the fallen angels through their children, the Nephilim, the giants. They were leaders of men. There's all kinds of mythology about giants. There's all kinds of mythologies, as we mentioned, the Olympics, Mount Olympiad, Clash of the Titans, all of these things, Apollo, the Book of Revelation, we have Apollyon. I'm jumping all over the place, brothers and sisters. I'm trying to tie all this together. Now, as the days of Noah were. So the flesh was corrupted. Now, the Book of Enoch says that they even changed the animals. They messed with the animals. What did they do? Just like what they're trying to do today. As the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man, brothers and sisters. What are they doing today, this very day in science? They are trying to make super soldiers, all kinds of experiments out there on this island off the coast of New York City near Long Island. I forgot the name of it. Where they're doing all these experiments, is this is one place that people know about. They are trying to make super soldiers. They're like trying to take the DNA of the eyes of a spider and put it in a man or a cat and put it in a man so they can see at night. All of these kind of mixing of DNA, brothers and sisters. This stuff is documented and it's out there. They're making all of these kind of things, brothers and sisters. So as I said, just to refer back to what the Book of Enoch says and take it and think about it, if you don't want to accept it as from God, see it as just the idea of what this thing was saying, because there's a copy of the Book of Enoch found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. So it was definitely written before the life of Christ. Now, was it written by Enoch himself? Their argument is that part of it was and part of it was added. That's why it was removed from the Bible, because part of it is original and then it was added to, and that, you know, they haven't split which parts are original, which parts are not. But anyway, listen to what the Book of Enoch was saying. And it makes sense. Okay, you have the whole point is God sent the flood not because some people were doing a few bad things or whatever. Some people were sinning. Okay? God destroyed all flesh. Why? And he picked Noah because Noah was perfect in his generations. Noah's blood was not contaminated. Now follow this. There's so many things I want to tell you. I can go on and on and on. Let's try to get this basics down and cover the ground. People who read the Bible who are not Christians, like this old atheist guy, he's in the news all the time from HBO. What's his name? Bill Moyer or whatever his name is. He said, I've read his quotes. I haven't seen his show. He's saying that, God that would send a flood and kill these people, he's so mean and he's crazy and blah, blah, blah. Of course, he's blaspheming God. But it is a question. Why did God destroy all the people? You know, it seems extreme. Why did God tell the Israelites? I mean, this is what you're dealing with non-believers. When they hear these things, these are the things they use to justify that the Bible's not real. Okay? This is why I'm telling you this. Besides the fact that we're preparing to tell people about the tribulation period, about the coming Antichrist. But there are a lot of people, when they hear this, they'll say, okay, that makes sense. Now I can accept why God did this. And then some of you may say, well, you know, who cares if people accept what God did? People will get saved when they hear this. That's the point. There are people who will get saved when they hear this, because it's an explanation of what God did and why He did it. Genesis 3:15, the first prophecy in the Bible. God said when He gave the punishment to Adam and Eve and the serpent, He told, you know, He said that I will put enmity between your seed and the serpent's seed, and he will crush his head. And, you know, this, and he's talking about the Messiah, Jesus, would bruise his heel when he crushes the head of Satan and the seed of the serpent. Now, Satan heard that. He was there. The serpent was there. And the Bible tells us in Revelation that the serpent is the dragon, is Satan. And he's the father of all lies, as Jesus tells us. So Satan was there in the garden after he had tempted Eve and the fall. He heard exactly what God said, that God was going to send somebody, a.k.a. the seed of a woman. You know, a woman doesn't have seed. Okay, there's a word that we use in English, semen, that comes from the same root word for seed. That's the real literal translation from the word, of the, you know, the Latin and the Greek and all that, is seed. Now, the seed only comes from the man. Women don't have a seed. So Jesus is known as the seed of a woman. He's the only one. As a matter of fact, if you get an opportunity to deal with spiritual warfare and you ever get a chance to cast out a demon, you can say that expression that, you know, the head of your master Satan has been crushed by the seed of a woman. When you say the seed of the woman, those demons know exactly who you're talking about. That's one way you know that it's someone who's really demon possessed and they're not faking or insane or just faking with you. 99% of people don't know who is the seed of a woman. There's only one person ever in the history of the world who's known as the seed of the woman, and that is Jesus Christ, the Messiah. He is the seed of the woman. Because, of course, God is his father, and all of his DNA came from Mary, his mother. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so Satan heard the prophecy that a Savior was coming, that the Messiah was coming. So what did he do? He did everything he could to thwart that. Okay, so he tried every way. One way that Satan tried is, he said, hey, if I contaminate all the bloodline, then the Messiah can't come. That's why the fallen angels came down and slept with women. That explains why they did it. That explains why God destroyed all flesh except for Noah and his sons, because he had to preserve the seed of the woman, because God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Hath God not said it? Will he not also do it? That's a Bible verse. I have to say that now because I realize more and more there are so many people that are so biblically illiterate, but yet they have all these opinions about stuff and they don't know one Bible verse, but they're some kind of expert because they saw videos on YouTube. So I always have to say, after I say a Bible verse, that's a Bible verse, FYI. So sad to say, brothers and sisters, it's the truth. Biblical illiterance is the biggest problem in the church, in the Laodicean church. And most of you don't know what that is. The Laodicean church is the last church age that we're living in now, the lukewarm church that the Lord will spew out of his mouth, the last church before the tribulation period begins. Anyway, brothers and sisters, Lord have mercy. So Satan tried to stop that through contaminating the seed of men, by trying to stop the bloodline of the Messiah. The whole Old Testament is about the devil trying to stop the Messiah from coming forth. Once you understand that history is his story, that it's all about Jesus, when you discover that it's all about Jesus and the coming forth of the Messiah, then you can put the Bible into perspective. So then, brothers and sisters, when the children of Israel started to go into the Promised Land, what did Satan do in the Promised Land? He filled the land with giants again. It tells us in Genesis chapter 6, before and after the flood. Where were the giants at? They were right there in the Promised Land. Why? Satan knew, as God had prophesied to Abraham, that the children of Israel would come back into that land of Canaan. It was the Promised Land that God had given to the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Satan was there waiting because he knew that he could try to mess up the bloodline again to keep the Messiah from coming forward. Why do you think God, you know, there's racist white people, as I mentioned before about racist black people. There are racist white people who use the text where God tells the Israelites, don't intermingle with these local people, to say that God is promoting racism. God is saying, don't, you know, black people don't marry white people. Hispanic people don't marry white people. Black people, Filipinos don't marry Americans. They use that text. But the real reason why God said that is because, A, they would fall into the religious idolatry of the local people, and number two, because those people had Nephilim blood in them. The Rephaim, whatever they are, all those people, even Goliath, David and Goliath. We see the battle between David and Goliath. Goliath was a giant. These people had contaminated blood from those more fallen angels who came. Obviously, the Bible doesn't tell all the things that happened. The Bible's not a complete 100% history of the whole world. But those fallen angels, obviously, after the flood, as it says in Genesis, more fallen angels came down to earth and slept with women again that we don't have the details for in the Bible, because there they were. Lo and behold, there were giants in the land of Canaan for some time between the time that Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob was there and the time that Joshua crossed over, you know, or, well, Moses was still in charge at that time, when the time when the 12 spies went in, when they were released out of, you know, in the Exodus, there were the giants again, just waiting to contaminate the bloodline, to stop the bloodline of the Messiah from coming forward and make God a liar. That's what they're trying to do. God could, as you say, God could get, you know, a Messiah from anywhere else, but God had made those promises to David, and, you know, that he was going to make to David. God had made those promises to Abraham. Out of your seed, you know, out of your seed, singular, you know, he'll bless all the nations, you know. So all those promises God made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob could only be fulfilled through the natural blood seed of Abraham, which is the Messiah. So what did Satan do? He tried to destroy the children of Abraham, tried to destroy the children of Isaac and Jacob. That's what the whole story of the Old Testament is about, trying to stop the Messiah from coming forward. Well, brothers and sisters, the Lord Jesus Christ did come forward. God is not a man that he should lie. God, this word does not return unto him void. God has fulfilled his word. Literally, Jesus literally came. He literally was born of a virgin. He literally died on the cross for our sins, and he literally rose again, and he literally appeared to his disciples and to more than 500 people at one time, and he literally rose to be seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will literally come back for his church to rapture his church out of here, and then he will literally return to earth and land on the Mount of Olives and split that mountain in two. Zechariah chapter 14, he will walk through the Eastern Gate, also known as the Golden Gate, right in there to the Temple Mount, and he will rule and reign for 1,000 years right there from the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. This will literally happen, brothers and sisters, just like everything else God has done, literally happen. It's not figurative, but literal, brothers and sisters. It is literal. There's lots of people who get confused between what is literal, as I mentioned before, and what is figurative. The Bible is to be taken literally unless otherwise stated by the text. And obvious, Peter had a vision about the wild animals in Acts chapter 10. The Lord said, rise and kill and eat Peter. And Peter said, "No, nothing unclean is coming out of my mouth." And God said, don't call anything unclean that I've called clean. God was talking about the Gentiles to Peter in that case. It wasn't literally. He was talking about eating animals, even though in a way he was. But figuratively, it was a vision, and the interpretation was God was talking about the Gentiles can be saved also. That was the purpose of the text. These are examples, and I mentioned Revelation chapter 1 lots of times in Revelation. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the Olympics is a celebration of what happened in the past, of the fallen angels and their children, the Nephilim, and the competition and the power and the superhuman strength of the giants. And it's the Olympics. Think about this, brothers and sisters. The Olympics stopped way, way back in ancient times. And the Olympics have started again just in the last 100 years. Another sign of the end times. The Olympics was restored, just like the Nephilim will be restored, just as the days of Noah where they're coming back. Another thing, I just want to throw this on there about the end times, as the Lord is just reminding me. You know, I just read an article where the Pope is, you know, celebrating and promoting the Latin Mass again. And it just came to my mind when I read that, how God restored Hebrew, as he prophesied that Hebrew would be restored. Ancient Hebrew that hasn't been spoken since the life of Daniel, about 600 BC, 580 BC. They spoke Aramaic when Jesus was on earth. They had Hebrew for only in the synagogues. So it was ceremonial, like Latin is now. But then Hebrew, being a dead language, was restored by God in the early part of the 20th century. came back, and now ancient Hebrew, Hebrew is the national language of Israel, just as the Bible said it would be. And then I thought how the language of the Roman Empire was Latin, and of course also the in Catholicism. And now we see a possibility of a resurgence or a revival of Latin, the ancient language of really the fourth beast, which leads into the fifth beast kingdom, the revived Roman Empire. We're talking about the beast kingdom, not the beast himself, but his kingdom. A revival is Satan would copy God's language of Hebrew. Satan would copy it with a rise again of Latin. Wouldn't it be, of course, I can't see the whole world speaking Latin. I see English as, you know, the it's the international language. It would be wild, and just, a, you know, just in my mind, wouldn't it be wild if, and something that would make sense if Latin became, you know, the official language of the revived Roman Empire. They would go back to Latin as opposed to English. Now, that's a tall task, but who knows? They might start using it more. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've been going on and on for a while. I've been covering lots of territory. There's lots of other stuff. That's why I haven't made any videos, too. It's just so much to tell you guys. Lots of you guys have already heard this. It's written in the book that the Lord gave me to write. And brothers and sisters, when you look at the Bible in the context of the sons of God as the angels of the Old Testament, and you look at how Satan spends all of his time trying to thwart God's plan, even in now, in modern times, Satan is trying to stop. As an example, here's a modern example. Satan doesn't want, he knows the prophecy that Jesus will return, as I quoted from Zechariah chapter 14. Jesus will land on the Mount of Olives. It'll split in two. He'll walk right down there through the Kidron Valley, right in through that eastern gate into the, then the eastern gate is sealed. It's been sealed up for hundreds and hundreds of years. And it's just waiting for Jesus to come back. But you know what the Muslims did? They put a graveyard right in front of that place, in the Kidron Valley, in front of that gate, because they believe it'll keep the Messiah from, you know, because of Judaism, the Lord would not be able to step on these graves because he would become unclean. So they think they can stop the return of the Messiah, really under the hand of Satan, by having those graves there. Number two, of course, the Dome of the Rock up there on top. Satan thinks that's somehow going to keep Jesus from coming back, from the temple being rebuilt and all these things, because the Dome of the Rock is up. These are literal, physical, modern-day examples of what Satan tries to do to stop God's plan from coming forward. Look at all the trouble you mentioned about David and Goliath. Look at the Gaza Strip. Goliath was from Gaza, from the Gaza Strip. That area of the Gaza Strip has been an area that Israel never was able to conquer properly. The areas that Joshua and the guys and the people of Israel failed to conquer in those days, as God told them under Joshua to conquer all these people, kick them all out and all this, the areas they failed to take is the same areas they're having trouble with today. The exact same areas. The Gaza Strip has been a thorn in the flesh to Israel since the day of the Philistines and Goliath. And it's the same people, same location, same area. It's in the ground. It's a spiritual thing coming from the territory. It's territorial spirits over those places, brothers and sisters. Those watchers, those powers and principalities, God has his holy powers and principalities. And then, of course, there are the fallen powers and principalities, forces of darkness in high places. Even as we see in Daniel 2, Angel Gabriel talks about the prince of Persia, hindered me, and then the prince of your people, the nation of Israel, Michael, the archangel, had to help Gabriel to break through to come to give Daniel a message. Brothers and sisters, all these things are just alluded to here and there in the Bible. Particularly, some great information comes out of the book of Enoch. That's why I encourage you to read it, because it gives a lot more detail on these things that are alluded to, like in the book of Daniel. As I mentioned, the watchers, the principalities, all these kind of things, get more details of the inner workings of this thing. I wanted to mention this as I alluded to it before and I didn't get back to it. Demons try to possess people. They're looking for a host. I think I mentioned that. You know, and that's why they want to have these half dog, half cat beasts that are created in a lab that they're already doing. That is a vessel they can use because God didn't make a spirit, a cat dog spirit. Only in the cartoon is there a cat dog. God didn't make a spirit for the cat dog. So if I made a cat dog, I'm like God. I created a new creature to me. But to God, it's a beast. It's a beast to God. That's why, just to cross-reference this, when King Nebuchadnezzar had his dream in Daniel chapter 2, he saw this beautiful statue of gold, silver, bronze, and all that. Daniel saw the same kingdoms, but from God's perspective, they were beasts. They were beasts. So to God, these kingdoms and these creatures and all that are beasts. They're evil. They're freaks. Freaks of nature, not created by God. But to man, they're a beautiful thing. You know, and that's, I'm keep going on and on, brothers and sisters, and tying all this and connecting all this stuff together. It's just like when the hurricane hit New Orleans back in those days, 2005, I was doing some preaching there at one of the churches that was started. It was still in somebody's house at that time. And the Lord really spoke to me when that hurricane hit. Things are not as they seem. You know, to the world, New Orleans is a great place. They love it. Mardi Gras, the Gay Pride Parade was started there. The day that that hurricane hit was supposed to be the Gay Pride Parade, but the original first ever Gay Pride Parade was in New Orleans. So to the world and to all the evil people, hey, New Orleans is great. It's the home of voodoo. It's the home of the Mardi Gras. It's the home of the Gay Pride Parade, all these things. But to the Lord, all of those things are evil. All of those things are bad. Same thing is true with lots of things. You know, what's good to God is bad to the world, and what is bad to the world is good to God. That's the whole reason why Christians who are of the world, being of the world is incompatible with being a Christian. John tells us that if you're friends with the world, you're enemy of God. You know, if you're a friend of God, you're enemy of the ways of the world, brothers and sisters. That's exactly what it tells us in 1 John. We're at enmity with the world. We're enemies of the world. Brothers and sisters, let me keep going as I'm doing this. I'm hitting on this same thing to just flow all of this together so you can see these things as the Lord shows me. It's as above, so below, brothers and sisters. As above, so below. All this stuff, this ancient wisdom and mysteries, all this junk they're trying to tell you, all this New Age stuff, all of the Masonic rituals, even the Masonic symbol of the square and compass, it's as above, so below. What does it boil down to? Look at Washington, D.C. Look at the Washington Monument. What is the Washington Monument? There's also an obelisk right there in Vatican Square and St. Peter's Square. What is that? It's a phallus symbol. A phallus symbol symbolizing the fallen angels. What is the dome of the Vatican? What is the dome of the Capitol building? It is the pregnant belly of Isis. Going back to Egypt calls it the pregnant belly of Isis. You're talking about Tammuz with the Babylonians. What is this? It is the daughters of men pregnant with the seed of the fallen angels, which is represented by the obelisk. That's why all these ancient cultures are worshiping these obelisks, these phallic symbols. They are remembering the traditions, just like with the Olympics. They're remembering the traditions of the children of the fallen angels and the daughters of men, the giants. As the days of Noah were, so shall the coming of the Son of Man be. Those beasts, the beast, the first beast, a.k.a. the Antichrist, the second beast, a.k.a. the false prophet, they are coming back as they were in the days of Noah. That's why the Bible says, who is like the beast? Who can make war with the beast? He has a fierce countenance. He appears as a man who can do lying signs and wonders. I have yet to see any politician, particularly since lots of people have this popular idea that President Obama is somehow the Antichrist. I haven't seen him doing any lying signs and wonders. He is just another lying politician, another puppet on a string in the hand of the Illuminati, who are puppets on a string in the hands of Satan. It goes all the way back to Satan. Satan is the god of this world. Even the Lord Jesus Christ said that Satan is the god of this world. This is his world until the Lord Jesus Christ comes back. So until that day, Satan is control of all of these politicians are in the hand of one leader, Satan. Satan. So as above, so below. They want it to come back. They do everything pattern after what they saw from these fallen angels. That's what they're doing on earth, is to pattern that. I could go through all of that. I've made videos about it, talked about it. We as Christians, we try to do pattern after, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, the third heaven where God is. Let God's pattern, like he told Moses, make the tabernacle in the wilderness after the pattern I showed you in heaven. We as Christians try to pattern ourselves after Jesus. Jesus said, I do what I see my Father do. I can only do what I see my Father do. Jesus did as above in the third heaven as below on this earth. Let thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Satan's people do what the fallen angels want them to do. Pattern after the second heaven, after the powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places, brothers and sisters. Same principle, but a perverted principle. Just like a husband and wife, the Bible says marriage is honorable among all, and the marriage bed undefiled, just as God made a marriage bed undefiled between a husband and wife for procreation and for unity, bond, and pleasure, and all that stuff. Satan has sodomy and bestiality and all those things as a mockery of creation, as a mockery of God's a blessing. And, you know, and pornography is a mockery of God's holy gift that he gave to mankind between a husband and a wife to give them, you know, that love and bond and unity and procreation. Satan makes a mockery of all of these things, everything, music, angels singing in heaven, the redeemed who were already in heaven singing and rejoicing in heaven. Satan was the anointed cherub that covers and really the worship leader of heaven when he was Lucifer before his fall. And now we have Marilyn Manson and all these things, evil, wicked, you know, devil worshiping music, rap music about killing, drugs, gangsters, you know, all this evil prostitution and killing and all this cop killers and all this music, so-called music, a perversion of God's creation of beautiful music sang in heaven and in church. When we do our praise and worship, or, you know, even here, each one of us, when we do praise and worship and worship the Lord, it's mocked and blasphemed and distorted and perverted by Satan in all of his ways. Every topic you can think of, it's the same thing. God created something perfect and holy. We, the church, try to do below as above, and the devil and his people try to pervert and do the opposite, to mock and blaspheme God. So next time you're trying to wonder if something's a sin and what should I do, this, that, and the other, the Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do we renew our mind? With the Word of God. We renew our spirit with His Spirit. The Holy Spirit renews our spirit, and His Word renews our mind. So the Word is for here, and the Spirit is for our spirit. The Word is for our mind, to bring every vain imagination, every thought and vain imagination into captivity to the Word of God. Brothers and sisters, I've been going on and on because I haven't made a video but one in the last week or two. Praise God, I've covered lots of information, and I've made lots of videos on these topics in the past. This is just kind of putting it all together, trying to take it to a new level in a review. But the Lord keeps telling me, brothers and sisters, those of you who watch my videos, the Lord keeps telling me the fleur-de-lis is the key and the symbol of the Antichrist. It is the fleur-de-lis. For me, as I study deeper and deeper, the Lord always brings me back to that fleur-de-lis. And as I say, one thing, way it manifests. Now, there's always someone that messaged me and say, the fleur-de-lis is a representation of the French monarchy. There are fleur-de-lis that they found in ancient Babylon, okay? The fleur-de-lis goes way back before France was just a happy thought in the loins of their forefathers. So, a little bit of knowledge is dangerous. Go research and you will see these things. It never amazes me that people are so quick to speak and slow to hear when the Bible says to be slow to speak and quick to hear. You know, if we would, you know, I've got a brother who's an atheist and he talks continuously 24 hours a day. And I always ask him, how do you know anything when you're always on output? You never have an input button, you know, it's always output. I don't know how he ever hears or learns anything because he's always on output, not on input. Brothers and sisters, when I'm making my videos, I'm on output, of course, because I'm making a video. But most of the other time, I'm on input. You got to be on input sometime before you can have some output. You got to be able to receive, digest it, pray about it, meditate on it, get it worked around in your mind and in your spirit. Then that's when the Lord can bring it out if it's going to mean something to the body of Christ. God bless you guys. You know I love you guys. I ask you to continue to pray. We've got a bunch of new orphans. We still got orphans coming in. I think we're at 15 orphans, maybe. 15, maybe it's even 16 by now. I'm still waiting on some photos from the latest ones. I ask you to pray for that. Full-time orphans, I'm talking about at the orphanage, not counting the 500 kids we feed. I ask you to pray for those things. I'm not sure, again, brothers and sisters, where I'm going to live when I come to the States. I ask you to pray about that. if you have any idea or if you feel led, you know, maybe about me living in your area, please contact me and tell me, you know, who, what, when, where, why, and how. You know, well, I'm thinking about starting a church, a physical church, besides our online church, which our website's getting going some. It's going to be getting more and more. We're going to have a live chat and all this, a flowing chat. I'm going to do a weekly live broadcast. And it's Church Firstborn. Church of the Firstborn is the name of the church, virtual church. But the web address is below this video, Church of Firstborn, I think is what was available. And we're going to have a live chat. We're going to have all these different discussion boards. We're going to have different groups for, like, divorce, drugs and alcohol, abortion, you know, recovery, healing request, prayer warriors, all that, you know, you guys, I've been talking about that. We're getting it organized. We're getting it together. It's already up, but, you know, we're going to keep adding to it and add to it. I don't know how long it's going to take because we're going to keep adding and adding and adding and adding as the Lord leads. And I pray to God it will take off and we can help thousands of people. All you guys who are mature Christians, you know you are welcome to help me do it. And there'll be a place for you to minister to people through, you know, this prayer request and things like that. And as some of you I've already talked to, what's your area of expertise that you feel led? Like, as a matter of fact, if you had an abortion before and now you're a serious Christian and mature Christian and you want to counsel people and minister to people who have had an abortion or thinking about getting an abortion and all this, let's talk. Let's pray about it. You know, by the grace of God, you know, you can do it. You can deal with those people through this website or whatever, alcohol and drugs, stuff like that. You're a former drug addict, you know, and you want to help people get off of drugs or, you know, try to break the addiction. Hey, you're a mature Christian. There's a place for you to help do the ministry and minister to those people. It's a chance to help people do something for the Lord. So God bless you guys. I'm going to go now and praise the Lord for his blessings. I'm going to be going, I'm praying about possibly going to Houston for a day next week on Tuesday or Wednesday, and then going on to Dallas. I'll be in Dallas 2 days. I'll be able to see people on the 20th and 21st. Contact me. I may have time to see a few more people in Dallas if you contact me in the Dallas area. I'll try to fit you in. I think I can see a few more people. I'm trying to see people one at a time or in small groups, not too big of a group. Anyway, contact me, and then, of course, I will be in the Bakersfield, California area, Las Vegas area, and surrounding area in the last week of February and the first week of March. God bless you guys. Love you guys always. And I have lots of more videos to make. Lots of things the Lord's been showing me, guys, about judgment coming. Amos 3:15 talks about an ivory house being destroyed. And the Lord asked me, what color is ivory? What color is ivory? That's what I'll say. Now you can figure out the rest. Talk to you guys later.